again, it'll pop up on here.
Yep. And ultra low latency, do your magic. There you have it.
Rock on.
Yep.
Damn this. I feel like I'm in one of those multiverse movies, just like watching a different version of me. Cool.
Yeah.
Wish you could like zoom in and stuff.
Yeah.
That'd be so cool.
I'm like trying too.
Like, right. Go.
Alright, so then it's now streaming. Here it's streaming. And I'm just gonna leave it as that.
Okay.
Should
cool.
be set.
Cool. But after 20 minutes it's just gonna turn off unless we do something? No.
It'll continue as long as there's activity. So as long as,
oh, as long as people are moving?
Yeah, yeah. As long as there's a nice workshop on grad stuff, we're good to go.
Awesome.
Yeah. Was that good?
So, yeah,
any
for questions? Sure. There, of course, there are going to be questions. this time, I still think it would be a good idea for me to be able to watch how you handle things in case stuff comes up.
Like issues?
Yeah.
No problem.
And then after this one, be like reverse. This is the way that I personally learn best, if you're comfortable with it. Watching somebody very closely and engaging in things periodically. Mm-hmm. And then them watching me to make sure I'm doing everything correctly. Does that sound cool?
Sounds great. Sounds
how long are you planning on being around today?
5 more minutes.
Yeah. So
as long as
I
need to be. I have a meeting at noon, so I need to figure out a way to have a room to myself so I can do my meeting. My mom's.
We have multiple rooms you can have to yourself.
Yeah.
There's well, we can give you the. I'm assuming
room.
Give you the key for the peer coach room.
Yeah, there's
right?
No peer coaches today.
Nice.
Perfect.
Very nice.
Cool. So we should be good. Yeah.
Cool.
I would just leave this here.
Cool.
Or maybe in the back somewhere.
I was gonna put it back here because it's like whoever's monitoring and like this can also make sure people sign in.
Yeah, they're gonna have to crawl to the camera if something's wrong.
Yeah. Right. So that, but now that I see that it's a bit more active in terms of like camera involvement, it's probably best for it to just be right here.
The problem is I didn't want it to put it too far back because the microphone's kind of eh.
Yeah.
So the closer it is to the incredible presenter, the better the Oh, do you guys have VR headsets in here?
The answer to that is yes.
Are they in here?
They are in this, but it is locked.
Oh,
do you want to test one out?
It would be really cool to be able to see what it would be like in VR.
Yeah.
That'd be cool.
But you realize you're going to set that up too.
Aha! Really?
I don't think we've figured it out.
That's fine. I started a VR lab at my college.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's why I'm here, right? I started all the 360 VR stuff.
It's badass.
By the way, did you let my mom choose the candy for you guys? I was like, what are you doing? Just grabbing the worst thing. I'm like, no. Got the M&M's or something.
I think your mom knows where you live.
You're right. She doesn't know I have this though, huh? No, I have my own Oculus too, so.
This is so cool.
Are you logged into the thing?
Yeah.
That's cool.
You can see the whole room.
It's like moving around.
Yeah. You just have to move the phone. That's
still, like, it's gonna weird me out every time I see myself do something I just did.
Gotten a chance to play with headsets here?
I have not even tried. I was telling your mom, like, when it comes to new technology, I'm super. stress.
My mom's
so
not learning on her own.
Yeah.
Don't worry.
It, even in my home life, we have something called This Week with Dave and Technology, which is just when like my phone or my charger or something starts messing up and I just start cursing and I can't stop. It's just like, David, just let me do it. Does it look cool?
It does, but it definitely still needs to be set up, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like asking a parent everything, so. So that could be a project for a different day.
Yeah.
Starting to figure out my rhythm, right?
It's the rhythm of survival.
Right, right. Honestly, it's IT work. I don't know if you have that IT department here, but I'm pretty sure they do as much work as I do.
So, Susie, your workshop starts in 1 minute, right?
Yeah. It does.
How clear were we that these aren't exclusively online this time?
Sanitizer.
Just nobody's.
Isn't that anti-fog? Oh, anti-fog.
It's for when. I didn't have the other one, but I have the one.
So I will.
How are you doing?
I feel good. Ooh. I'm excited.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's what. No, it's not.
And Leo, when we want to stop this, I just relocked it.
Oh,
that's
fine.
Yeah, sorry.
It's okay.
When we want to stop this, we just hit the shutter button again, correct?
Yes, so that will stop sending the data to YouTube. We have to go on here and click the stop stream. Just right there.
Okay.
All right. So I can't see the fingers over there. Yes. So somebody needs to manage the Facebook.
That's not me.
No. Somebody needs to manage the messages on Facebook.
I will be. While I sit here, I was just gonna unlock the thing to put the VR back.
Did
you get the VR to work?
No, it needs to still be connected to like the mobile app and stuff like that. It's still set up.
You have the table there. Yes, and why? Okay, so did you bring the microphone?
I'm gonna fill up my water really quick.
Oh, there's one for you right there.
Oh, I know, but I don't.
You don't want to waste?
Yeah.
What time is your meeting?
Actually, do we need Creo Center? Because signed in the front, they're good to go.
Yes, we need them.
We still do, okay.
Yes.
They're just doing both signs.
Yeah, this is the, we have to attach that to all the rest of the stuff for the documentation. Yes, you have the key?
Yeah, I put them right back on my desk.
And if there's an issue, you can text me.
Cool, I don't know if I have your phone number. Yeah, there's pens and stuff right over there. Sir. This ends at 12:30.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah, you can leave it here. Okay. You were the boss. You were like.
Thank you. Oh, I also, we could do this like on Wednesday because I'll be here again, but I want to go over like my reward letters with you, if that's okay.
For sure.
Yeah.
We can do it. We're not doing too many meetings this week. I can definitely do it next week. In terms of world, have you scheduled an appointment with Columbia Central too?
I haven't, no.
They're going to be probably the best people to go over what your age is looking like. Mm-hmm. Although I can literally see your award letter in terms of balances and stuff like that. Our access is pretty limited.
Yeah, because I just had a question on one I loaned. It didn't appear on my Columbia site yet.
It didn't? Okay.
But it's on award letter.
That means it should have kicked in.
Yeah,
if it's on the award letter, that's usually the most current. But we can look at that.
Yeah,
sure.
That's the only thing I'm missing. It's like $6,000.
Yeah, that's a lot.
I know. Like, I gotta make sure it's in there.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, we can go over that.
Okay, sounds good.
All right, I'm gonna get started. It's 11:35. So, welcome to day one of Trio Week. My name is Susie Sanfigueras. I am a Trio advisor. And today I'm going to be presenting on grad application process and what all it means to apply to grad school and how you decide that important decision. And so I want to start first with, there we go. What is grad school and how is it different from undergrad? Does anyone want to take a stab at any one of these questions?
I'm guessing it means like you already did your 4 years, and so it's like the aftermath of it.
After your bachelor's, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Correct. Yeah. So, you start with your bachelor's degree if you choose to go to college, and with your bachelor's degree, you receive a 4-year degree that gives you a broad base of knowledge and skills in a specific major. But you also need to take gen eds and electives, right? And so you complete this degree in 4 to 5 years, typically, of study. And then if you complete this degree and you choose to continue your education, you're moving on to your master's degree, which is essentially going to grad school. In grad school, you you are participating in an advanced program of study that's focused on a specific subject or a specific profession. And so you're doing a deep dive into one subject. The main difference is that the master's degree typically takes about 2 years, and you are taking very specific classes, no gen eds, no electives. And then if you choose to continue your education after your master's degree, you can get a doctoral degree. So this is your PhD, your Juris Doctor for lawyers, and then Doctor of Education for people that wish to work in education as professors or different administrative roles within education. When you get the PhD or the doctoral degree, I mean, you become an expert in your field, right? It's the highest degree possible that you can get. And it usually requires independent research and publication. And then you typically complete the doctoral degree in 5 to 7 years, but it's really, it varies because the doctoral degree is typically self-paced. So it can take 5 to 7 years or more. All right. Okay, so then when you decide, or when you're thinking about grad school, you will get hit with this question, right? Should I go to grad school? And there's many factors that go into this question, but it starts with you, right? And so it's really important that you do a deep dive into your interest and your passions to answer this question. And so you have to do some self-reflection here and think about the things that you find most enjoyable, the things that you can see yourself doing, you know, years down the line and as a career, right? After you do that, some deep soul-searching, some self-reflection, you want to connect those passions and those interests to professional opportunities. So this is where informational interviews, internships, part-time jobs, and different events come into place. So you want to attend workshops, like the one you're at right now. You want to go to networking events, things that will give you more of a first-hand knowledge of what the career or what the subject area it is that you're interested in. And so it's important that you use resources that Columbia has to offer. So LinkedIn is a good one where you can connect with professionals who are working in the field that you wanna, that you want to be in. Handshake to find internships and part-time jobs. And then the Career Center, right? Because it's important that you get some advice from Career Center advisors, mentors, faculty members, people that have a little bit of knowledge about the grad school process and also the profession that you wish to explore. That's when it'll be important to really use your resources. I really like to use LinkedIn. So this is a sample email that I sent when I was on the journey towards grad school. And I think that right now, it can be very nerve-wracking and very just nerve-wracking and intimidating to ask a stranger for career advice, right? But you'd be surprised how willing people are to talk to college students. And so right now is the time to take advantage of the fact that people like to talk about themselves, especially to college students. And it could be as simple as a LinkedIn email template saying, "Hi Donnie, thanks so much for connecting with me. A little bit about yourself, you don't have to give away too much." And then just ask them for 20 to 30 minutes of their time. Next, you want to do some research. And so going to grad school is a very time-consuming thing to do. And so it's important that you do some very well thought out research before you decide to go, right? It costs a lot of money and it costs a lot of time. So research will become very important. You want to research programs in schools that, and then determine which programs are best suited for you. So making a pros and cons list, right? And then I want to go over some of the things that you want to research. Number one, program characteristics. And so I have here theory versus application. And what I mean by that is that is the program more theory-based? Are you learning more about theoretical frameworks, theoretical ideas versus real-world application training? That'll be important depending on the job that you want to get. Next, number two is funding. College is expensive, I'm sure you all know that, and grad school is no different. And so programs will vary on price, but there are ways to fund it. Loans is a safe first step because there's federal loans that are specific to grad programs, and they have low interest rates, and then you can pay them after you graduate and you get your degree. So that's a good first step. But there's also scholarships and grants. And so these are typically, question? Oh, sorry, I thought that was a question. There's typically grants and scholarships that are offered through the school that you can apply to, but there's also external scholarships. And here in TRIO, we have a list of external scholarships that we have available for TRIO students. Yes, Will.
What is the location?
I'm getting there. Yeah. And then so I will get there in just a second. I'm just going to finish up about graduate assistantships. That's another way to pay for grad school. Graduate assistantships and teaching assistantships. And essentially there, you are employed by the school and you get a stipend. Either it's paid at the end of the semester or throughout the semester. And some graduate assistantships will also cover a portion of tuition. So that's something else to look for when you're looking at grad programs. Location is another thing to think about, and this is a very personal decision. Do you want to be in a city or in a rural area? That's completely up to you. And for some people, that's more important than others. Something else to think about is, do you want to be close to family, or are you ready to move on and be somewhere else? Also, is there job opportunities within that that location? That'll be important, especially if you're looking to get some real world training while you're in school. And then number four is curriculum. So the curriculum, the classes that you will be taking in the grad program, is usually posted on their website. This is really simple. If the classes don't pique your interest, you're probably not gonna like that program. So think about looking at the class descriptions as well. All right. After you have done some research, it's time to gather your application materials. So organizing and prioritizing all of these materials becomes really important. And those materials are, number one, the application. The application has just some basic personal information, your name, address, and other contact information. And then your transcripts, schools do want to see your grades and the classes that you've taken. And so you want to submit those as well. And then some programs require standardized tests. The most general basic test is the graduate record examination, the GRE. And that is typically required for most grad programs, but there's also the LSAT for law students, the MCAT for students who are looking to get into the medical field. Just a note though, there are many schools that are now waiving this requirement, and they're not requiring you to submit standardized tests. It's becoming a little bit more common now, but it's something else to keep in mind. Next, they're also going to ask you to submit some writing samples, and one of those being the personal statement. It describes your background, your experiences, personal challenges, goals, and your motivations for pursuing. degree. This is your chance to for the admission committee to get to know you more as a person. So it's like the name states, very personal. And so you will want to write about your experiences. It's also an opportunity for you to stand out in the crowd and explain why it is that you feel like this program is best for you. So it's really the chance for you to convince the admission committee that you are a right fit for the program. And the personal statement, sometimes they'll give you a question or a prompt to answer, but essentially you're answering those things, your background, your life experiences, your personal challenges, and motivations. And the questions might be answered differently, but in every personal statement, this is essentially what you're telling them. Next, we have your letters of recommendation. So the letters of recommendation are personal references. I wrote here, the best letters are written by faculty members who are directly involved in your education. But mentors and advisors can also write you great letters of recommendation. The key thing here is to make sure that you ask your professors or your advisors with enough time to be able to write you a solid letter of recommendation. And then some programs will ask for one, some will ask for two, some three, it really depends as well. I recommend that you keep a log of all of these requirements. As you can see, there's a lot of things that you have to submit. So it's important that you keep track of all of the things that the program is asking for. And the way that I did that I would like to share, is through a very simple spreadsheet. It doesn't have to be color-coded and numbered and fancy. Mine was very simple. You just write the name of the school at the top, the program name, GPA requirements. As you can see, most of them, all of them, asked for a minimum of 2.75. GRE, do they require it? Marquette didn't, but DePaul did. So some do, some don't. Application deadlines, they all differ. And then letters of recommendation. So Marquette asked for 3, DePaul asked for 2, and then, and so on. And then a personal statement. So here I wrote a note about what they were asking for. This one specifically wanted professional and academic goals. DePaul wanted a personal statement indicating your experience in higher ed. And so this question, like you can see, it'll be slightly different, but they all want to know why you want to be in that program. Some asked for resume, so you might have to submit that as well. And then leave a space for comments, right? Because some of them required an interview. So I made a note of that as well. A timeline. Okay, so this is an ideal timeline for when it's a good time to start prepping and applying for grad school. So in the fall or in the summer before your senior year, or 8 to 12 months ahead of the application deadline, it's good to start exploring graduate programs, seek advice from your mentors, advisors, and then start to prepare for the GRE. There's practice tests that you can take. And this is a good thing to consider at this point. 6 to 8 months in advance, you want to actually take the GRE if they require it. And then you want to complete your first draft of your personal statement. You want to submit that to a career advisor, to a mentor, or a faculty member, so they can give you some feedback and you can revise it. It's important that you do at least 2 or 3 drafts of the personal statement, right? Because this is what's gonna really determine whether or not you'll be accepted. And so it's important that you make changes and you have a couple people look at it. At 6 months, it's good to start to talk to your faculty members, let them know that this is your plan, and if they're willing to write you a letter of recommendation. Then 4 to 6 months ahead, complete the final draft of your personal statement. You want to start to apply, complete the application, submit it, visit the campuses if you haven't already. And then 3 months or less, around springtime, that's when you'll receive acceptances and rejections, and that's when you will let the school know whether or not you accept or decline their acceptance. Any questions at this point? Because that was a lot. Yeah.
How necessary is a portfolio if you're doing something like art?
Yeah. So there is a Master of Fine Arts. That's the highest degree for a art major. And so I believe they also require you to submit an art sample or a portfolio. That would be the only difference that I see.
Okay. How many schools do you recommend to apply?
I would say 3 to 4. I applied to 5.
Okay.
So I would say 3 to 5 is a good number. Okay. So I want to go back to my first question. Should I go to grad school? And then leave you with some tips. First, reasons why you should not go to grad school. Number one is uncertainty about the future. So if you're certain about your future goals, if you're uncertain about what you're gonna do, committing to more years of study is not a good idea because there's a lot of time and money involved in this decision. So you might find out that years down the line, you don't like what you're doing and you just lost all this time and money going to grad school. Next, avoiding financial obligations. So you might be able to buy yourself some time before those student loans are due by going to grad school. But it's not a good idea to do that because the loans are going to be waiting for you a little further down the line. And then making more money. So making more money is a good reason to go to grad school if going to grad school actually makes a difference in your earning power. So if it's actually gonna increase your income, then yes. So that's there. Okay, and then I wanna leave you with reasons why you should go to grad school. Number one, if the degree is necessary for the field that you want to go into. This is mostly like law, medicine, education. They typically require a graduate degree. And then two, if a degree is necessary to make a wanted career change. So if you get your bachelor's degree and a bachelor's degree helps you kind of get an entry into the workforce, and then you think, oh no, I want to do something else. That might be a good reason to go back to school and get a graduate degree. And then, if the degree is important for upward mobility and more earning, then that's another good reason to get a graduate degree. If it gives you a higher pay or a higher position, then it's a good idea to consider grad school. And then number four is passion for the subject. This is sometimes overlooked. But if you really love that subject and you feel like you can get a deep dive into it and you will be happy and content in that profession, then it's a good reason to go to grad school because job satisfaction is often overlooked. And it's just as important, I think, as your potential earning. All right, so that is it for my presentation. That was a lot. I know that grad school has so many moving pieces. But I wanted to give you all sort of an overview of what it entails. But if there's any questions, I'll be here. If not, we have lots more trio presentations all week.